This week, Three Sides of the Coin, we delve into the question, why hasn't the KISS catalog been recertified for RIAA awards? It sure seems like they've got more awards coming for albums like KISS Alive and Destroyer, Crazy Nights, and... We get into a big discussion with Martin Popoff all about
this. This is Three Sides of the Coin, talking all things KISS.
I want to rock and roll all night.
You're listening to Three Sides of the Coin.
Everybody, welcome back to another episode of Three Sides of the Coin. I think you need to kind of get used to this is going to be the format of the show for a short while. It's going to start with Mike and Tommy. Mark's going to show up with the guest. Then Mark's going to leave middle of the guest. And the show will end with Mike and Tommy again.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's just how it works out, and that's okay.
Yep. Yep. You're still getting your shows every week. Any comments you want to share, Tommy? Because I've seen some of them. This is our Bob Halligan Jr. episode that just... Yeah. was posted. I saw there are some of them out there.
Well, yeah, and it's interesting how a lot of people that were very familiar with his writing for other bands, like Ken P said he wrote Helix's biggest hit, Rock You.
Yep. Worked with Blue Oyster Cult.
Well, yeah, and Scott Beeson, Tone Loc, Funky Cold Medina samples Dr. Love, but I think it's Christine 16.
It's Christine 16. But
people are.
I was just going to say real quick, because it's out already. Just know the Tone Loc thing we were referencing wasn't that Tone Loc sampled KISS. It's the fact that at some point, even for a moment, KISS was considering having Tone Loc rap on Reed. My Body,
yeah,
from Hot in the Shade. Where and how, no freaking idea. It was just a passing comment from Bob as he was writing the song Read My Body with Paul. He said Paul right. mentioned it.
Well, and Nick Shade said 14 minutes in and no mention of his work with Blue Oyster Cult, definitely worth a mention among others. And I agree, it's just the thing that you guys, I want you to know, for those of you that haven't interviewed people before, is it's really hard to cover all the bases in
every
a
single
period of time, especially with people like Bob who have so
worked with many different artists.
Yeah, he's worked with so many artists. It's just like Holly Knight, you know.
Yeah, I mean, yeah, even Holly Knight. I mean, we didn't talk about her work with Bon Jovi and others. I mean, I would have loved to. It's not that we don't care. It's just there's only so much time. And we do have to get some KISS talk in.
Yeah, and I really like this one from Steven. Great episode, guys. What a warm, intelligent, and engaging guest this week. Great stories, questions, and a little education on the art of songwriting. Very happy you had Bob on. It was an hour 54 well spent.
Thank you. Love hearing that. Love
yeah. It. And you know, we do, you know, guys, we don't make any money off of this. All right. We do this because we have fun seeing each other every week, because it's the only way we can connect, but we want to make you come and be entertained. We want to make you be here with us and give you something to listen to. That's not just another rerun on TV. And we want to share stories and we want to educate at the same time. And I'm not saying
we want to learn. We want to learn a little minutia, just like all of you do. I mean, when we sat down with Bob Halligan, we had no idea we were going to get that little Tone Loc minutia drop on us. I mean, because again, understand, we do not do. Some people who do interview shows will do pre-interviews, meaning they'll confirm the guest. And then, you know, maybe a week or two before the actual interview, they get on the phone with the guest and they go through questions and they have a little back and forth and they get some pre-interviews to understand. And then they formulate the final questions based on. We do none of that. we approached this with, we just got pitched Bob Halligan Jr. by his publicist. Here's his bio. Here's what Wiki says about him. Cool. We'll talk to you when we hit the record button.
Yeah.
That's it. So we are excited, you know, when we heard that little tidbit about Bob Kulick on Kiss Alive, we got pretty excited about that, just like all of you did.
Everybody did.
Everybody got excited.
Yeah, and it's the point is it's never intentional. It just comes up in conversation.
It just shows up.
That's the beauty. That's the beauty of the show for me, is we learn, like Michael said, we want to learn these things because it's interesting. You know,
and you learn it while you learn it. Same time. Yeah. We're learning at the same time.
Yeah. So we're glad you like it. We're glad you're here.
Before we get to this week's guest and topic, we should mention real quick, the End of the Road tour now seems to be called the Final Curtain, because KISS has announced one more show going back to Australia in October, playing a giant stadium in Sydney. Mm-hmm. And I just saw today, it's not confirmed, so don't hold us to it, but I've seen posts that, yeah, there's going to be one more show in Japan as well, right around that. You know, the end of the road, they keep building more road to keep this going. And
detours.
I taking from what Mark loves to say, I don't have any inside knowledge. It's what I think. I wouldn't be surprised if there might be one or more shows announced in Australia as well.
And I wouldn't be surprised if there's a few more here too.
Here and Japan. Simply because when you're already in Australia for one show, you might as well do one or two more while you've got the band, the crew, the gears all there already. Mm-hmm. And while you're in Japan, why don't you do the same thing? So I have zero insight. This is the way all bands tend to work. They announce the first big show. If that big show does well, sells out, guess what? Second, third shows, other cities will be announced.
John's been on his farewell tour for 4 years, and he has visited St. Paul XL Center twice now. So it's like when it's successful, they want to come back. Why wouldn't you?
When the promoters are like, we want another show. Okay, when can we make this work? And while you're over here, can we get three other shows out of you as well?
Right.
So, KISS is returning to Australia. That is 100% confirmed. Check kissonline.com for the date, the venue, ticket links, all of that stuff. Nothing's confirmed about Japan, but I've started to see some stuff mentioned online. Yep.
So just watch kissonline.com.
Just watch KISS Online. And to Tommy's point, I wouldn't be shocked if there's more dates in the U.S. I think everything is going to be pre-December 1st and 2nd. You're not going to have a December 3rd show announced, December 15th show announced. You're not going to have a New Year's Eve show announced.
Right.
But between now and December 2nd.
There's a lot of open space.
There's a lot of room.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so I don't think there's anything else happening in the KISS world. There's no new product. Still don't know anything about more box sets. We don't know anything about next off soundboards.
Nope.
Just the Australia show. So this week, returning to Three Sides of the Coin, we've got Martin Popoff. Martin's an amazing guest.
Good dude.
Such a smart discussions we have with Martin. And this week, we kind of dig into the question of why hasn't the KISS catalog been recertified for RIAA awards? And Martin digs into some numbers based off of, especially streaming numbers, because streaming numbers play into award certifications nowadays. Why haven't we recertified Destroyer and Dynasty and Kiss Alive? There's a lot of interesting theories and discussions here. And of course, you get to play along and call us out and yell at the screen as we're doing this. But please leave your comments with what you think as well.
And don't wreck your TV or video screen doing it.
Yeah, don't throw anything at us when you get pissed at me.
Yeah.
Because I still believe Crazy Nights is probably actually a 10 million seller.
Oh boy, look at the time.
Let's see who believes that was a true statement I made and not just trying to stir the pot.
A toolism.
All right, so let it roll. Martin Popoff, and we'll see you guys at the end.
YouTube. Follow and rate us on Spotify. Subscribe and leave a review on iTunes. We appreciate your support.
Three Sides of the Coin, you should recognize this face. He's been here before. Although if you're listening, you don't see any faces. I keep forgetting that. Some people listen on YouTube and don't even bother watching us on YouTube. We're joined by Martin Popoff. Martin, is this two, three? How many times have you been here?
At least one. I don't think more than two. Might be just
all right,
two.
So this might be your second time. I don't know.
Yeah.
We don't keep track of those important
things. He's not in green jacket territory yet, but he's
God, no. No, he's not in Peter Arquette territory yet, is he?
I just remember getting in some trouble afterwards for saying Aerosmith was more sophisticated than Kiss. So,
well, it's true.
Listen, you know, it's not easy to get in trouble with Kiss fans. They're just looking for something to piss and moan about.
I love Aerosmith. I love Deep Purple, but they're both way 10 times more mature. They are. I think Kiss would tell you that too.
I mean,
it's all about that gold standard of trying to write the perfect song, though, right? There's an abstract out there that goes along with like your Billy Joels and your Fleetwood Macs and your Tom Petty's, right? And that's what Kiss would tell you. That we can sit down with an acoustic guitar and play these songs, right?
That they're concerned about writing the gold standard of songs. I think they're more concerned about how does the blood look coming out on stage tonight? Did that look good?
Yeah, as it should. I mean, hey,
Gene's always said it's not about how great you play on stage; it's how great you look playing on stage.
Yeah, yeah.
So Martin, we had an offline conversation a few weeks ago, and I don't know, Mark, you chatted with Martin about this stuff as well.
It was the three of us were knocking it back talking about this. And I know, was it a Sea of Tranquility show that you guys did? I mean, you covered it. I didn't watch it. I purposefully didn't watch it because I normally do. I purposely didn't watch it because I didn't want it to infiltrate this, you know, our talk. So Martin you know this stuff backwards and forwards. I don't. But it's something that I've talked about with KISS fans. And I think everybody who watches the show would be, you know, interested in this. You know, KISS makes the claim of selling 100 million albums worldwide, and a really quick Google check of, you know, awards, fuzzy math. So we'll start there. Martin, KISS, RIAA, and what do you think about all that? What do you think about their 100 million albums sold claim?
And being the number one gold award artist, whatever that, how they word that claim that they've been making for years.
Yeah. Okay. So my thought on this is, so a lot of bands can exaggerate those worldwide sales it's really hard to check your worldwide sales. And sometimes bands will say records instead of albums. So that brings in all their singles and stuff as well. So, you know, I'm not as much, upset or like losing brain cells over the 100 million thing. On the other thing that, you know, what they're trying to do. So this is indicative of why I think they should do more. So they are, you know, the last time I checked, I haven't gone and compared, and I don't think they would make this claim without backing it up. But their claim about being the American band with the most gold albums is something that is probably true. And now what that means is that they have the largest number, the largest quantity, variety of albums that have sold over 500,000 copies as certified by the Recording Industry Association of America in America, right? Now, what I find interesting about KISS, and this, we get into this discussion all the time, and this leans a little bit into the show we did with Pete, is there's a lot of bands out there that don't seem to go back to recheck and recertify and see if they've hit that next level. Have they hit platinum? Have they hit double platinum? Have they hit diamond? KISS is one that always comes up in that conversation. You know, the first thing people say, I can't believe KISS Alive is just gold, right? And even gold means 250,000 for a double album, right? So KISS is one that comes up. Iron Maiden comes up and we all wonder, why is Rod Smallwood not doing this, blah, blah, blah. David Bowie comes up and I know a little bit of the history around that. So there's a lot of reasons people don't do it. It costs money. You have to go get, the RIAA has this accounting firm that goes and, you know, does the counting. So you have to pay to go get the counting done. And then you have to pay to buy gold records to hand out to whoever you want to hand out gold records to. And bands can hand out gold records to all sorts of people, right? I only have one to my name, a Dio one that Wendy very kindly sent me for writing the liner notes for the very best of Beast of Dio, right? But you can send out, you know, to radio people and promo and anybody who helps you along the way. But, you know, you have to pay for those as well. Now, that's being kind of pretty nickel and dimey if you're actually not going to get certified simply because you don't want to pay the money to get certified. Where it gets a little more into the skullduggery part of it is labels hiding sales from the band, bands switching from one label to another, and it was really acrimonious. Management changing. I know for a fact David Krebs is a good buddy of mine, and I know that he's always on top of the albums that he's still getting paid on, right? Which is your Back in Black, For Those About to Rock, the Ted Nugent albums, Aerosmith Rocks, Aerosmith Greatest Hits. That red and white Aerosmith Greatest Hits album is diamond now, mm-hmm. right? So the show that Pete and I did, which, you know, what I'm going to talk about here is quite a bit different from that. But the show Pete and I did was just essentially going back and looking at recent RIAA certifications. So the point is that you can go back, management, depending how on the ball you are, management or the labels can go back anytime they want and try to see if they've hit that next level and get those accolades. Because I think that's another discussion we can have. How important is this accolade? Personally, I think at least for people in our age bracket, you know, pretty wide age bracket, I would say this is the biggest measure of how successful a band is because it's faithfully put on the wiki page. Wikipedia is really important. I mean, it's the source most people go to for stuff, right? And they've been very good at that. So listing all that there in a nice readable form. So Pete and I went back and you can go to the RIAA site and search under gold and platinum and you can search under recent and scroll through all that. And the funny thing that you'll notice is it's almost all hip hop and pop singles from you know, this year and last year and the year before and stuff. So it's been polluted and changed by this idea of all these bands think it's just fun to go get our multi-platinum certification for our single, right? But those pop singles also turn into albums and stuff. But if you scroll and scroll and go all over the place, you'll notice things like, hey, look, Alice in Chains just went back and got like five or six albums, knocked up a few notches, right? Perfect Circle. Journey, what was it? Journey Escape is now diamond. It wasn't diamond before, right? Rush, Permanent Waves, just like 2021, or not, Moving Pictures, is now 5x platinum instead of 4x platinum.
And so Martin, let our audience know what diamond is.
So gold is the first one that was 500,000. That was instigated, I think, in 70. Or no, platinum was in 76. Gold goes earlier than that. Diamond only came around in 1999. It means 10x platinum, so 10x 1,000,000. And there was an interesting, because I had to write about this recently. There was an interesting party at the Roseland Ballroom in 1999. That this is when they started the Diamond Award, and people from the Beatles and Zeppelin and ZZ Top and Billy Joel was there, and Elton John and Metallica guys, they were all at this party to get Diamond Awards. And at that point, there were something like 63-ish Diamond Awards represented by about 43-ish different bands. So Van Halen was one of the ones there. They now have two Diamond albums, right? So that's what Diamond is. Before that, you just called it multi-platinum.
And before we get too far down, I want to throw out just some framework facts for people to understand here. You mentioned it briefly up front. Like a double album counts as two albums sold. So, you know, Kiss Alive, Alive 2,
double platinum,
the double platinum, the symphony album, or if you've got a four disc album and you sell one of those, that counts as four. So that's how that works. Yeah. Keep in mind also, granted, we're going to focus on US here, but these numbers are different from country to country. So we're talking about what it is to get an award in the United States.
Yes.
And Martin, you could add to this. It's not the same in Canada, and it shouldn't be the same in Canada or Sweden or other countries, because the population differences. Yes. So in many other countries, gold could be 50,000 albums. Platinum could be 100,000 albums.
And it is.
That's Canada.
Exactly. So it varies from country to country. The other thing that I think is important to keep in mind through this entire discussion, the RIAA is not the company that does the accounting and royalties for any of these artists. Okay. That's the record label's job. The record label knows the sales. I shouldn't say on any given day, but any given quarter, they know the sales for all of their artists.
Yeah.
The RIAA is an industry organization that represents the music industry and is the organization that issues these awards. So the RIAA is not the company that's responsible for tracking the sales as an ongoing business. They are not the ones that sit here and go, KISS made this much money from sales.
Right.
That is not their job at all. That's 100% the label. So, you know, as an example, I'm sitting here at RIAA.com. I searched for KISS Destroyer. KISS Destroyer is a double platinum RIAA album, 2 million copies. You can be very sure that through Casablanca, Mercury, Polygram, and now Universal, the real sales numbers are known within the record label.
Yeah.
Now, I think what this comes down to is why doesn't these people that have the real sales always just go out and say, hey, RIA, here, we've got this. Can you update it? That's the ongoing question that fans have always had when it,
yeah,
especially albums like Destroyer, which again, and Alive, which we know are well over what their award certification level is. As for the 100 million, which we're not going to really talk about, but total sales, that's also, and you mentioned it in passing as well, that's also very difficult to tabulate, because there's different record labels in different countries that each of these bands are on. And each of those labels in those different countries are responsible for the sales in their territory, meaning Universal Music is responsible for the territories that Universal Music covers here for KISS in the US. You know, they've been on different labels in Japan and different labels in the UK. Those labels are responsible for the sales. So it sometimes can be very difficult, if not impossible, to go to every single label. Hey, let me go to Brazil and see what are the sales. Good luck probably finding somebody who has that data and will release it to you. So those total numbers are always almost an estimation, a decent estimation.
Yeah.
I will say that in the case of KISS, you know, the record label has also used the 100 million. So it's not just Gene and Paul making up 100 million because it looks good. The labels use that in their own marketing. So other people, and yeah, you know, as fans, we could sit here and go, well, maybe it's closer to 50, maybe it's closer to 75. You could debate that until we're all blue in the face, because none of us are going to know the real numbers, because nobody other than the band, their manager, their accountants, and the record label are ever going to know the exact number of sales.
Well, okay, let's talk some real numbers here. So you'll like this. So, okay. Mm-hmm. So first of all, before we get to the numbers, there is the issue of, okay, so yes, KISS is one of these bands that is, you know, if there's a graded scale, they're way over here on really, they haven't gone and checked very much, right? Okay, so I've got so Destroyer, which is a kind of an oddball. I don't know why this is, but they actually got that recertified in 2011. KISS was certified for the first time ever. So in 1977. So what they're doing at this point is, like, the band's all excited and Bill Aucoin's their manager and all this. And oh boy, let's get some gold records. Wouldn't that be neat? So they're keeping an eye on it. They're checking and checking, and KISS hasn't gone gold. It hasn't gone gold. Oh, 1977 rolls around. It's gone gold.
Martin, do you think they did that for the inside sleeve of KISS Alive 2? Remember the claim?
Yeah, well, but I think they're doing it for the accolades, right? They're excited still about it. I guess they're not excited about it now, right?
Can I add real quick?
Yeah.
We don't know by they that it was KISS that went and recertified Destroyer in 2011. We don't know. I mean, the label could have done it just as easily as the band could have done it.
Yeah.
As far as I know, those are the two entities that can do that. The band and their management, the record label. And if you go and look on the RIAA.com, it doesn't tell you who requested the recertification. It says the date it was certified, the certified units. So it's not like 2.5 million. It just says 2 million.
Yeah.
So I just want all of our geeky KISS listeners out there to understand, we may use the word they, don't take that to mean we're always saying Gene and Paul, because we don't know. None of us know. And other people can actually go out and do the certifications.
Okay, so to finish off on this, just to drive home the point. So Dressed to Kill, 77, Alive, 1975, never been relooked at again. Or if it has, you know, by some crazy nook, you know, hook or by crook, it hasn't gone past gold, but we know that's wrong. Love Gun, 77, Alive 2, 1996. So in 1996, somebody went back and got it redone. Dynasty, 1979, Animalize, 84, Crazy Nights, 88, Hot in the Shade, 89. So only the one time when the album came out and it sold a lot, that's the last time for most of these albums, Revenge, 1992. Now, the next big issue here is that what we're talking about here, and why this is kind of exciting for a band like KISS, because, you know, I'm going to tell you, they've got some certifications coming here. So the point is that, you know, I mentioned all these hip hop singles and pop singles, right? Physical product died in about 2005, you know, big drop off, right? We had a very short period of downloads. So that was a legitimate thing for a very short period of time. Streaming started. It took off. It's a streaming world now, right? So Spotify is roughly one third of the streaming market. Amazon Music, 13%. Apple Music, 15%. Those numbers really haven't changed. I've seen a few. I looked up a few, you know, 2023, they're saying Spotify's varied a bit, blah, blah, blah. So the new RIAA thing to get certified, so it still exists. And that's why there's all this exciting new certifications happening, and especially for these pop and hip hop groups. 1,500 streams equals one album sale. Okay, so 150 million streams is 100,000 in album sales. Okay. So let's say Spotify is one third of all of it. Okay. So I went and looked at a couple of KISS examples, and this teaches us a really interesting lesson overall about the power of the hit single. how big a single is, right? So I'll start with Dress to Kill. It was the first one I looked at, okay? So I wanted to look at Dress to Kill because it's got Rock and Roll All Night on it, super popular KISS song, right? So every song on Dress to Kill has been streamed. So Spotify, the nice thing about Spotify is it tells you exactly the number of streams right next to every song. And I'll just put as a caveat on the side, when I did the show with Pete, I did a little research and read up the long details on the RIAA about that. They've got it down. They seem to have it pretty down with making sure there's no double counting between greatest hits albums and the original album. You can only count a song in one place. So just putting that aside for a sec. So every song on Dress to Kill on Spotify has been played 1 million to 5 million times, except Rock and Roll All Night, which has been played 392 million times. Okay. So that's 409 million plays on Spotify of the Dress to Kill album. Okay. Now, since Spotify is one third, you can multiply that by three. So you get 1.277 billion plays, song plays across all streaming platforms. And so that equals, let's see. So you divide by 150 million. So essentially, Dress to Kill, if KISS, Doc McGee, Gene, Paul, the record label went back, it works out that if I've done my math right, it works out that Dress to Kill has sold just basically on streaming. Forget about the physical copies between 1977 and 2005, right? Lots of physical copies, right? We had 12 years of hair metal in there. Like KISS sold some albums in there, right? KISS was a going concern. They have been the whole time, right? Touring. So forget all that. So they've essentially sold, just by streaming alone across all platforms, 800,000 albums. So Dress to Kill's at gold at 500,000. Streaming alone, it's got another 800, which means it's well past platinum. It may even be double platinum by now if you brought in the physical. So that's your live example.
One thing, Martin. Dress to
Kill example. Yep.
And I don't know the exact numbers for this, but it's only been within the recent last year or two. I'm pretty sure YouTube video streams now also play into RIAA calculations as well.
I don't know how that works. Yeah. Because I've seen pie charts without that on it. So
yeah, it initially started where it just covered streaming music, and it's only been fairly recently, meaning within the last couple of years, I think, mm-hmm. that YouTube video is now incorporated into it. And again, one of the big reasons, not just that's the way music consumption has changed, is before they incorporated streaming numbers into this calculations, mm-hmm. nobody was getting awards for anything, people. Nobody. I mean, I remember a number of years ago in the category of rock, there was one album in the year that even hit gold.
Okay.
So, you know, the point being, nobody was getting awarded anything because albums weren't selling. So how do we update and stay with the times? Well, we've got to figure out how to incorporate, you know, audio streams, video streams, because that's where, quote, the kids are getting the music these days.
Yeah.
So the artist should be able to credit that to a certification.
Okay, so here's a couple other examples. I didn't do that many. I've only got a few here. But so Destroyer, I thought I'd look at Destroyer, big popular album, right? Shout It Out Loud, 18 million plays. Detroit Rock City. Here's the other thing I didn't look up, and I don't know, but I wonder across all these streaming platforms if some of them skew to an older classic rock crowd and some of them skew to a younger pop crowd. Not sure. Anyways, Detroit Rock City, 12 million plays. Beth, 59 million. So it's not super high. That's not a lot of numbers, right? So total for Destroyer, 118 million plays on Spotify, times three, because Spotify is a third of the market, 354 million streams. So that only works out to 236,000 units, but that's still halfway to a gold record. So, you know, given that Destroyer was kind of an oddball one that somebody decided to check on Destroyer not that long ago, it might not even have gone an extra one up. But as you were saying, Michael, we've got Destroyer at double platinum, which is kind of cool, right? So I don't know if it's triple. So Alive's a funny one. only 15 million streams on Spotify. So times three is 45 million. So Alive, in terms of streaming, only accounts for another 30,000 units. 30 over 500,000 is not very much, right?
Did you do Dynasty by chance?
Yes, I'm getting to that one. That's a really cool one. And I know why you're very smart to ask that, of course, and we'll see why. So Kiss, only 117 million. Well, actually, it's a fair number, 117 million. It's times three is 351 million. Divided by 150 million is 2.34. So Kiss, which is only gold, just from streaming alone, has halfway to gold. It's got 234,000 more full album units based on that 1,500. So Dynasty, here's the funny thing about Dynasty. I Was Made for Loving You has been played 750 million times. So a quarter of a billion times. Right?
It is the most popular song Kiss has on Spotify.
Cool. Okay. So the entire album in total comes up to 796 million. So they only add 46 million for the whole rest of the album, right? Times three is 2.388 billion divided by 150 million equals a factor of 15.92 times 100,000. So the way I worked it out, Dynasty has 1.592 million extra sales just from streaming. So it's got for sure at least a whole extra platinum. And so the last time Dynasty was ever checked to do this was 1979. So you've got all the physical sales from 79 through to the death of physical sales plus 1.5 million. So Dynasty, easily you can add another two platinums on top of that. So my big question is, for this band who really loves accolades, and you know, we know they like that, we know they like to win, they're competitive, and you know, certainly they should know that, you know, most of us dispel any importance of Grammy Awards, American Music Awards is gone, you know, everybody complains about the Hall of Fame. You know, obviously Gene might say, well, my bank account is the most important thing, but really the most important thing for 100 years from now for Gene's kids and their kids is, you know, if there's a planet at all, what it's going to say on Wiki for how many times platinum these albums are. So I think this is a huge accolade that's just sitting there, and somebody in the Kiss camp is remiss in not going and checking on a bunch of this stuff and getting some of these. Now, granted, when I did this exercise, I realized that, it's not all sunshine and roses all over the place, but there are certainly six more certifications. And, you know, I've often, as I said to you guys, I've thought, you know, these guys know publicity. They're smart about publicity. You know, imagine one of those big old school, certification parties, and they get on all the mainstream news and Fox and CNN. They're all standing there in front of in all their makeup glory in front of all these new certifications they're getting, you know, right when that time when maybe they're trying to sell the catalog or they want to sell more tickets for the end of the tour. But it's just a great publicity thing. And it's a huge, massive accolade that, you know, I'm just sitting there seeing, you know, Aerosmith blow them away out of the dust with all these diamond albums and seven. Toys in the Attic just went diamond. I mean, Toys in the Attic is a diamond album. Kiss's biggest album is 2x platinum. It's sitting there for everybody to see. And if I was Kiss, I'd be embarrassed about that because they could have more and they don't have more. And like I say, the reason all of that is known is because David Krebs stays on top of it and he goes and gets those certifications done.
Well, you know, I'll chime in first on this. And this is sort of just a continuation of what you and I were talking about offline. And maybe part of this is just being devil's advocate. At this point in Kiss's career, which it is the end of the career, the career is basically over in just a few months now. Their ability to have accolades and brag about stuff. Listen, they're bragging about 100 million albums sold. That's a pretty damn big brag to make. They are bragging about being the American band with the most gold albums. Whether it still holds true and all that, we're not getting into that. That's a big brag. And you're 100% right. I mean, Gene and Kiss have always been about over the top promotions and bragging. But I sort of feel like maybe at this point in their career, they got enough to brag about. They don't need to, what, you know, they're not going to have any problem selling tickets to the December 1st and December 2nd shows in New York City. You know, being able to say Alive is actually a diamond album isn't going to sell one more ticket for them at this point. So it might just be a case of, I'm Gene Simmons. I got plenty to brag about. I got plenty I can legitimately brag about without, and I don't know how long it would take to do a recertification. I could safely bet it's not done in 30 days, and it might take a year to do it. We don't know. And we have no idea of the cost or who would pay for that cost. You know, maybe KISS is like, if we got to pay for it, I don't need to pay an accountant to do this, to get another gold album, another platinum album. Because as we know, Gene is offloading all of that stuff to his museum anyway. These guys at their level probably have more awards in storage than they have walls to put them on.
Give them to Mark.
If you are a newer, younger band, it is very much a thing of pride. I got my first award. I can brag. I can show it. But, you know, when you're KISS 50 years down the road and, you know, from around the world, they've probably got thousands of these awards, each of them. And it just might be a simple fact of, at this point, it's not that important anymore for them at this point. It means a hell of a lot to us fans. We are the ones that seems like every month somebody's bringing up the discussion of why isn't it recertified recounting.
I've got a question for both you and Martin, because you guys are closer to it. Gene has that plaque, very famous plaque, with the 100 million records. I imagine that's from RIAA. And also, I sent Martin, when we were talking, in the KISS Billboard special.
There's no way that'd be from RIAA. Go on.
Okay, but in KISS is advertising KISS Alive. Double platinum over it. I remember that ad I sent you, Martin, a 2-page ad, double on one page, platinum on the other, both with the images of KISS Alive. Well, someone's lying then. I mean, or well, someone hasn't. And that's the next. All right, so Martin, you said, Gene's plaque could not have come from the RIAA.
The RIAA doesn't certify the world. They just certify the U.S. There's awards issued by other countries that have the same meaning, but there isn't one worldwide organization that oversees every territory in every country. No. And what makes all of this so confusing at this point, especially, but it's been going on for years, the companies that make these awards, the official RIAA awards, will also gladly make a fake looking award. Hey, listen, I mean, we did it for our podcast. You know, I went out and made an award that we all got that said Three Sides of the Coin.
It's right behind you.
Yeah, 8 million there. That the one behind me is for 2 million, but we also had one for 8 million. You can make those up. And listen, when I went to the company and said, I want it with two, like the one behind me, for 2 million plays, they didn't ask me to prove it. They asked for no certification, nothing. They're like, okay, great. That's going to cost you $300 to have us make that award up. How does this design look? So the 100 million award, I could almost bet you that was for some form of a PR photo opportunity. The record label was probably like, yeah, that's pretty freaking impressive. We will assist in putting this together. but it's not certified sales. It's just, here's an award. You guys have been doing great. Look at this. I mean, I've seen the same thing with ticket stubs. You know, wasn't it during the Psycho Circus tour, KISS made an award that had all the ticket stubs from every ticket wheel? It looks great. You know, and keep in mind, perception is reality. So if you make up an award, most people don't know the difference between a legit award and a not legit award, being the hologram seal that's on there. I mean, even for the longest time after the reunion, KISS was doing, you know, fake awards with, what was the company, Cal Gold? They'd make, you know, oh, they'd make a little plaque and they'd put a little seal in there. None of it was legit. It was the album. It was the spray painted silver, so you think it was platinum. So that's what that $100 million is from. And as to the ad, you were probably, I'm only guessing again, as long as it doesn't say RIAA certified double platinum, then they could probably just say double platinum, 2 million albums sold. We know that based on what the record label knows the sales are. So I'm guessing there's a requirement or a process if you want to say it's RIA certified versus it's just an award for 2 million.
Yeah, because I wish I was home because I could pull that out of my collection to show you guys. But in the Billboard, when Billboard magazine did the salute to KISS a few years
back. Yeah, I remember that.
Well, that's what I'm getting at. They had Rock and Roll Over with the album cover. It said platinum across it. It had, you know, Love Gun, platinum. And then when it came to Alive, it said double platinum, and it was two pages. And, you know, even myself, when I'm looking at that, I just assumed that, but I
perception
also
perception is reality.
Yeah, yeah. Well, again, that's what I thought was, especially the physical product. Like Martin made a great point, you know, especially during the hair metal when vinyl, hard rock, and metal was just going through the roof, you know, in the mid 80s and stuff. All those format changes. I mean, I bought Alive on cassette, vinyl, 8-track. I mean, I had every CD.
When CDs came out, we all everybody who's listening rebought your KISS collection on CDs. And then when they remastered them, you bought them all again. So that's three sales for the same album right there. The original sale, the first issuing on CD, and then the remaster.
And you know, Martin, there's a subject right there. Which band has remastered their catalog the most? And I think it's Motorhead.
Yeah, and you know, you don't even have to really use the word fake for these awards. Like, for example, Van Halen could go get a really nice award made up that
puts
their two diamond albums.
You're right. I don't want
it's true,
fake,
right?
Fake isn't the right word. It's just an award. You can I mean, it's just like you could have remember the days when you used to be able to walk into a mall and there was that engraving place that you could go buy a plaque and have them engrave the world's greatest. I mean, it's the same thing. It's anybody can go get an award plaque made up and look identical to an official certified award.
Yep.
You just don't have that hologram seal on it.
And Mark, a lot of those ads that you see in the industry mags, especially, you know, I don't know if the KISS Alive one is like this, but a lot of them are simply a subset of what we're talking about with 100 million. Like you would just say KISS Alive, 2 million copies sold worldwide. And that's an easier calculation even than the 100 million. But even the 100 million, you know, it sounds high. But basically, you could spend 5 minutes thinking about it or 2 hours or a couple days and just go through all the countries and just on the back of an envelope, add it all up. And that's obviously what they did. And then Paul probably just said, OK, now double it.
You know, just right. Yeah. Right? Now they're like, well, it came to 80 million. So we rounded up. To 100.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Yeah. So but yeah, so it does. It still strikes me as I would think for posteriority, you know, Michael, you say, oh, they got rooms full of awards. It's not even that. It's just having the statistic there and having it there on the computer forever and official in RIAA, showing you that this is what you sold. And I think that's something that these guys should be, handing down to their grandkids, basically, these accolades, because it's a true accolade. You can't take it away. It's not something that's going to get burned up in a fire. It's there. It's official in the most official place ever, which oddly enough is Wikipedia, at least for all of us who do all these video shows and podcasts all the time. It's super important. It's
Martin, do you know the cost? What would it cost KISS per record to get recertification?
You know, I don't know that, and I couldn't get that answer. I even emailed the accounting firm. So Michael brought up two good points. One was the cost and how long does it take? I don't know either of those things.
Yeah, I mean, there's a lot of unknowns to this, and it's just an interesting topic because it is one of the topics fans, and I'm sure it's not just the KISS fans, it's any artist fans are like, that's not right. We as fans want, sometimes I feel like we as the fans want the bragging rights more than the bands we love want the bragging rights. At some point, I think the bands are just like, oh, Jesus, another award?
Yeah. Well, I don't know. There's but KISS and Golden Platinum Awards seems like something real sensible that they would want the bragging rights for. So I don't know. It just seems like every time I see this, I think, why is Rod Smallwood not going getting this done for Maiden? I feel like it's something like, they're trying to be too cool or too punk rock, or they don't care, or they're trying to show that they don't care or something. The Bowie one, for example, just quickly, like I know there's a lot of stories about the red tape and the different record labels and the Tony DeFreeze, the epic battles and court cases and stuff. So that's often quite a lot of it too. When you've got a band with one label and then they go to another label, like, even in the Aerosmith camp, there's some politics between that shift between Columbia over to Geffen, right? And then back to Columbia, right? So.
Yeah, 100%. I mean, it's just one of these things where there's unfortunately, we don't have access to get to the important information. It makes sense. I mean, that's accounting. That is the actual sales.
Except nobody's, we can add up the math. I mean, we just, I think, proved that there's 800,000 more.
Oh, no. Deals. We
100%. 1.5 million more dynasties, right?
We can do the rough math for sure. But at the end of the day, it comes down to the actual accounting, the actual, quarterly accounting from the record label. And, to your point, Martin, when you start getting multiple record labels or labels that get bought out and bought out and bought out, I imagine sometimes it can be hard to trace the data accurately all the way back. Where was this report? Oh, that was the old company and that accounting firm is no longer around. And, it can be challenging. And why some artists don't go for it? I can only imagine to some extent they care about what's going to make them money. That's it. What I'm going to make a priority and focus on in my career right now is what's going to actually make me money, not take the time out and do something that isn't going to make you money, going to give you gold stars and awards and accolades, but doesn't actually put more money into your pocket. And to all of our point, who knows how much it might take out of your pocket too. I mean, if KISS said, I want to recertify the entire catalog, how much money would that take to recertify an entire catalog? How many people, do you have to take your business accountant off of accounting ticket sales to now say, now you got to go out here and, sit down with the labels accountant and go back and forth. I mean, I know when I worked for the merchandising company and they did an audit of sales, their accountant was in the office for a week to 10 days. just looking at merch sales.
Yeah.
So, you know, a 50-year career, and it's not like KISS has just a couple albums. I mean, you're talking, I don't know, I've even lost count of how many albums KISS has ultimately ended up releasing here. When you start,
yeah,
you would also want to count greatest hits, because in KISS's case, and a lot of these classic bands, as the years go on, it's the greatest hits albums that sell much better than the studio album themselves. Because, you know, the casual fans like, yeah, I want to get all the cool songs on one album, so I'm going to buy that. I mean, that's why Smashes did so well in the 80s for KISS, because it was a greatest hits album. That's why, you know, I'm looking at You Wanted the Best, You Got the Best, you know, greatest hits album.
Like I say, the interesting thing is when you go and read the rules over at the RIAA. So if you're going to count up greatest hits albums, I think you're stuck in that physical mode, because you're going to still want, I think you're going to want that song to count on the original studio album. So, and also to your point, it's like KISS doesn't have to go back and try recertify the whole thing. It took me like 5 or 6 minutes to figure out which ones had potentials. And you could go back and just go after the ones that's got I Was Made for Loving You and Rock and
Roll. But you know, here's an interesting point. You're right. It, you know, they take the, like Detroit Rock City, they take it one time. But according to Spotify, and I'm just glancing here, Detroit Rock City has 206 million streams, but it's from the Smashes album.
Yeah, so each one of those would have to be added up if you wanted to do Detroit Rock City in total, correct?
But no, but they won't.
We only count it once.
We only count it once. So. Yeah. So do you sit here and go, okay, I want to count Detroit Rock City off of the Smashes album, not off of the Destroyer album, because it's considerably more streams coming from this album. It starts to become a bit of a head scratcher of like, okay, where do I want
Michael,
to pull it from?
I did check that at one point when I was just before I did Pete's show. I checked Don't Stop Believin', and it had the exact same number on the greatest hits album as it had on the other. So it's like it knew it was getting it right.
It did. Okay.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Let me, while you guys are chatting, let me double check that.
I got an interesting question to ask you guys. I mean, what does this, you know, again, you know, those numbers bear out that you could get all your sales in the streaming era through the math by having that single do all the heavy lifting. I wonder how much the singles did the heavy lifting when you had to buy the whole album. What do you guys think? Like, how important was I Was Made for Loving You for Dynasty sales?
Huge. Huge.
Just like Beth was for Destroyer. The singles, I think the singles drove so much of that. And that's why the singles were so important.
Well, that's why Gene said to Lydia that Beth saved us, because the album stalled. Casablanca had very fuzzy math, very, very fuzzy math. And they were saying back in 76 that it stalled around 800,000. And then, you know, Beth came out as a single and the record picked up. And again, I have no reason to not believe those numbers. I always just kind of thought that Destroyer was probably like 4 times platinum in the United States. You know, I have nothing to back that up fact wise with, but just by feel. Although right now, especially when you say Toys in the Attic is diamond now, I will not put Destroyer in at diamond, but I wouldn't put it this way. If Toys in the Attic is 10 million, I'm going to guess Destroyer between 7 and 8. Just because of the lexicon of how big Aerosmith was at the time and how big KISS was. And
yeah, but Aerosmith had those two huge singles, you know, Sweet Emotion and Walk This Way, that still are radio staples to this minute.
Yes, yes. Way more so than Beth even, you know.
Oh, God, yeah.
Yes. Mm-hmm. So, you know.
Can't get away from those songs.
But I love this that, you know, Dynasty has been played, individual song plays 796 million times, with 750 million of that being I Was Made for Loving You.
I Was Made for Loving
You. So all the records, so the 1.5 1.92 million album sales. All, you know, 1.4 million of that, the heavy lifting was done literally by the single, like direct mathematically by the single.
And I think it's just very interesting that just looking at the Spotify numbers, the 750 million for I Was Made for Loving You dwarfs the number two single, which is Rock and Roll All Night, which is 392 million. Detroit Rock City is the number three single, 206 million. Heaven's on Fire is number four at 149 million. And Lick It Up is number five at 77 million.
I would have put Lick It Up ahead of Heaven's on Fire just because of the soundtracks and stuff that it's been. Wow, that's surprising.
So I mean, as KISS fans, that's, you know, it's like, wow, I Was Made for Loving You is not the song the vast majority of KISS fans would ever pick as being their most listened to, most popular song. But the numbers don't lie. It is heads and tails above Rock and Roll All Night, which a lot of fans would go, well, that's got to be the number one. I mean, Beth isn't even in the top five.
Yeah, for the record, I must have screwed up my Destroyer numbers because I had Detroit Rock City more insignificant than that. So I'd have to redo all my Destroyer. But so you're saying it's saying 200 million, eh?
206,371,772 okay. Detroit Rock City.
So it's at about 300. So it's at about 300. So it's about 300 times. So Destroyer now, let's see, 300 times. So it's probably adding another platinum on at least.
That would make sense.
Yeah. Interesting. Yeah. But yeah, a lot of gold records, like you say. I mean, you know, so here's the other thing. I know the Rolling Stones were always super, super serious about making sure every one of their albums got to gold, and they would do, you know, move heaven and hell and buy ads. Paul McCartney and the Wings, too. When you look at all those old Sounds and Melody Maker and Enemy magazines, there are so many Wings ads in all those magazines. Like, because I kept a big collection of them. I've got a collection of 4,000 of these, long story. But basically, you could tell that, you know, a lot of the success that you got from Paul McCartney and the Wings, people don't know this, but I guess I'm gathering this from this idea. A lot of it has to do with, they did a lot of advertising for that band. Right. So, you know, that's why it's kind of neat that KISS did, you know, get all of these, a whole lot of these records to gold, and they do have a lot of gold records, but it's just a bunch of golds and a bunch of single platinums. It's not that impressive in the large totals. I had a couple other numbers here that I aggregated just for kicks, but you know, Monster, the entirety of Monster has been played 23 million times, the entirety of Revenge 64 million times, the entirety of Lick It Up 87 million times, Love Gun 94. So yeah, I guess another question would be, how do things skew for the demographics across all these different, you know, platforms as well? I don't know. Is there a young platform? Is there an old person's platform?
I don't know. I really haven't. I haven't heard that breakdown when it comes to streaming platforms. It's just, you know, I think what this sort of is illustrating, that what KISS fans think is not necessarily what reality is painting out. Because again, let's just rock and roll all night. You know, Alive is not in the top five most popular here. But to KISS fans, that would be the
quintessential.
That's quintessential. That's the peak. But I think what this is saying is, to the vast majority of people who listen and buy, then they may not be buying KISS Alive. They may sit here and go, yeah, you know, Paul keeps saying this out. This song came off of Alive. This song came off of Alive. But I'm going to go buy the greatest hits record. I'm buying the greatest hits record. I don't want a live record. I want the song, and I'm going to get 20th Century Master, I'm going to get Smashes or whatever. And you got to really, you meaning us listeners, us KISS fans, this is another one of those things where maybe we shouldn't be looking at this through our rose-colored KISS glasses. We need to step back and go, what's the general public playing, listening to, and buying? And clearly we can tell they're playing in Dynasty, I Was Made for Loving You.
Yeah.
Before anything else.
And it's a bunch of young people probably too. Hey, I've got some stuff here you guys might be interested in. So just I'll tell you a couple of the highlights from the show I did with Pete in terms of what we saw in terms of new certifications. So Billy Joel, The Stranger, 11 times platinum, October 18th, 2022. So these are all things that have been certified in 2022. Bruce Springsteen, Born to Run, 7 times, Greatest Hits, 6 times, Wrecking Ball, Gold, Born in the USA, 17 times platinum. Deal, Holy Diver, this was a great one. May 6th, 2022, it's now double platinum. So it's until Black Sabbath does something about it, Deal, Holy Diver looks like it's twice as big as Heaven and Hell, because Heaven and Hell is still platinum, right? Soundgarden, Super Unknown, 6 times. The Doors, LA Woman, someone went back in 2021, it's now 3 times. Zeppelin 4 in 2021, 24 times platinum. Aerosmith Greatest Hits, 12 times platinum. Oh Yeah, Ultimate Aerosmith, 3 times platinum. Toys in the Attic, 9 times platinum. So it's not diamond. Godsmack, Where Legends Rise, gold. Journey Escape, 10 times platinum. Buck Cherry 15, double platinum. ELO, gold for classics, gold for the essentials. So that essential series, Michael, everything you've been saying about those physical sales, this is physical. This is records, CDs selling in Walmart that is getting in there, these things, right? All Over the World, Very Best of Gold. Rush Moving Pictures, as I say, 5 times platinum. Queen Platinum Collection, 5 times platinum. Good old Vinnie Paul, hell yeah, gold. February 25th, 2021. You got a gold album for Hell Yeah. Queen Greatest Hits, 9 times platinum. Tool, Fear Inoculum. Let's see what else we got here. Nirvana, MTV Unplugged, 8 times platinum. Back in Black is now 25 times platinum. So again, David's getting paid for all these still.
But I want to remind people once again, just because it got recertified to 25 million doesn't mean that the artist and the people involved all of a sudden made a lot more money.
No,
because again, that certification,
they're getting paid anyways.
They were getting paid quarterly statements from their record label for the entire career.
Yeah.
The certification doesn't say, all right, now we're paying you more on this. And just guessing here, maybe some artists are like, listen, the accounting statements that we've been getting every quarter for the last 50 years from our record labels, spot on. We've audited them many times. There's nothing being lost or disputed there. We're getting paid what we need to get paid. Mm-hmm. So an award isn't going to change anything in that sense. It just is going to be, again, a cost to somebody to verify this, and time. And some artists, that's important to them. Others might sit here and go, it's just not that important anymore. I don't need a diamond album on my wall. I got the freaking checks from the record label in my bank account. What would you rather have?
Yeah.
If there is a dime, because I got to get out of here. If there is a diamond KISS record, I would think it would be either Alive or Alive 2.
No, I don't think they have one. I don't think they got anything close to diamond. I don't even think they got a 5 times platinum.
Well, Mark, I mean, go by the 250,000 the each record. So if that thing went legitimately gold, which it did. I'm saying when I say that, I mean, if you were to count both records at 500, meaning as if it was a single, I would think that thing would have sold, KISS Alive would have sold 4 million, double it, 8 million.
Yeah, maybe a lot.
We would think that as KISS fans, but let's just look at just one other side that's possible. Maybe they know that something like Kiss Alive is only 3 million through their sales and their quarterly accountings they've been getting and getting and getting. And therefore, we don't want to go back and certify it to show that all these years later, it has only sold 3 million.
That's
when
a good point.
When fans like to live in the fantasy that it's a 10 million seller.
Yeah.
You know, maybe in Kiss's case, certification will prove they didn't quite sell as well as we, the fans, would like to think.
Well, yeah. That's one of the reasons that just as a fan personally, I've always kind of, I don't know, the 100 million thing always made me uneasy, just because the bulk of really any successful rock band, for the most part, is U.S. sales.
Yes, 100%.
So knowing that, you know, a band like Led Zeppelin or even Aerosmith, they obviously sold way more records for the records that they released. That's the one little skew about the Kiss Gold record thing. They put out a lot more records, a lot more product than, say, you know, Aerosmith did studio album wise. So there's, yep, you know, they've got a greater pool to make that gold record claim.
Yeah.
Just do.
Yep. Yep. Yeah.
And by the way, Mike, obviously that's your background, but didn't the best of Kiss, that thing did legitimately go gold, didn't it?
The very best of Kiss is a legitimate gold album award that I've got, 500,000 copies, RIAA certified sales award.
Yeah.
You wanted the best. And again, I don't know if they've changed, but when I got these awards years ago, you wanted the best is certified 500,000 gold. I've got a Psycho Circus certified 500,000 gold.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, you know, I mentioned it earlier, for these classic bands, you want another gold album. It's not as easy as it used to be, but throw out another greatest hits album and you're probably going to get gold off of a greatest hits album.
Yeah. Well, the last one I was going to tell you, these highlights. So this is a nice one. So Blizzard of Oz, first Aussie album, is in 2019 certified 5 times platinum, but the Essential Ozzy Osbourne 2019 double platinum for the Essential Ozzy Osbourne. So it's cool that I like that at Wiki as well. When you look at some of these classic artists, it's really cool to see, you know, go into the well and look at the greatest hits albums and see, wow, you know, their biggest seller was a greatest hits album. That is pretty cool.
I think even in the 80s, Smashes was double platinum for Kiss in the 80s. Okay.
Could be, yeah.
I think it might have been their best selling release in the 80s. It Smashes was. And then Crazy Nights.
Cool. Yeah, makes sense.
Crazy. Yeah.
Martin, I wish I could stay long. I'm at work. I think
we're done. I don't know if we've got much more to.
But I got to get out of here.
You didn't hear much from Tommy?
We'll let Mark get to work and then we'll wrap up with you, Martin. And
all right. Okay. Take it easy.
All right, bye, guys. Thanks, Mark. See ya. Yep.
Bye.
I'm curious to see how, like, some of the iconic soundtracks did, like, say, Saturday Night Fever, because, well,
you guys talk and I will search on the RIAA.com website.
Okay. Well, I know that's way up, and Bodyguard is one of the biggest selling albums of all time. Tons of those are, right? I've interviewed many bands who, I mean, Judas Priest is a good example. I think Dio as well. Bands that are just super regret saying no to being on some movie soundtrack, and then movie just blew up. And then other time, you know, and then they said yes to this stupid movie that everybody hates, right? And they
like,
you know,
Spring Break,
about, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
Well, and Johnny B. Good, Judas Priest, and I think they turned down something. That,
yeah.
You know, because you get, I mean, apparently you get quite a bit of pay off of being on one of those. I don't know how it all works out with the publishing. But yeah, some of those, some artists really got a really good paycheck by having one song on some soundtrack album.
Well, and you'd think also too that, and it doesn't seem like it's part of the criteria, but you'd think like for the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, they couldn't ignore bands who've sold millions and millions of records. but there's so many. I was listening to, I think it was Mark Striegel or someone on Sirius XM the other day, was talking about all the people that still are, or bands that are still not in the Hall of Fame. And it's just, I know the whole thing's a joke, but it's just hard to fathom that you have so many, like REO Speedwagon isn't in. Well, God, I don't know what was more popular in 1980, 81 than REO Speedwagon. Mm-hmm. You know, I bet that Infidelity has sold a shitload.
Saturday Night Fever was last certified November of 2017 at 16 million.
Wow.
Yeah.
Now I've got to try some different things here, but Smashes, Thrashes, and Hits, I wasn't finding. In
search is really finicky. You gotta play with it.
I know.
To get all of KISS up, the best way to do it is use the advanced search and just put in the band name and hit search, and then KISS will come up nicely.
Let's do this.
Yeah, and anyone can do this. You can hop on the RIAA's official website and search for all of this information if you're so inclined to do so.
If you get a comma wrong in Smashes, Thrashes, if you put an ampersand in its and, it won't give it to you. So you gotta.
Here we go. Smashes. February of 1996, it was last certified as double platinum.
Nice. Yeah.
Well,
that's the other thing that happens, Michael, is, you know, I didn't really drive this point home, but you'll notice with most classic bands, all along their careers, they'll have a clump where they said, all right, we're going back for a group certification. So you'll see albums, 3, 4, 5 albums at a time in 19. So obviously clearly in 96, because I mentioned another one that happened in 96, but yeah, a band just randomly will show up, Van Halen in 2001 or whatever. Okay, let's get 5 more done exactly right now. And so they go in batches kind of thing, right?
Yep. I'm just looking, and the RIAA also lists video releases. They'll do video, like Animalize Live Uncensored. Long form video is
radically lower numbers, though, Michael. That's flat, like a flat, it's 100,000.
100,000. They list it as 0.1 million.
Okay.
So, but
is
platinum.
That a gold? Is that a gold release then, by the standards of video?
It was certified gold in 1986 and platinum in 1987. So clearly 100,000 is platinum for a video long form. Gold was probably 50,000.
Yeah, I think that's right.
Okay.
And let me see if there's any other interesting ones here.
And there's funny things like Britain, for example, has like a silver award and a gold award.
Yes.
But they don't have platinum, I don't think. I've never seen anybody call a British album platinum.
KISS Alive
is a big one. So, you know, proportional to the population, the important countries are Japan, Britain, Germany. America's way biggest, of course. And then Canada, people think about. And everyone has it all around the world. And there's charts, you know, there's Finland and Bulgaria and all that stuff. And they issue awards too, but
with all the different artists that you write about and all the different research you do, was there any that popped up on this list in general that you were like, holy shit, this is way bigger than I ever thought it would be?
You know, Tommy, I love looking up bands that I never think about on Wikipedia just for the heck of it, right? You know?
Yeah.
And you know, Spinners, Atlanta Rhythm Section or whatever. Right. Garth Brooks is crazy. Look up Garth Brooks's numbers. You will be blown away. Like, he's got 3 or 4 diamond albums, that guy. So there are some nutty ones out there, but
I was going to say real quick, you can't sort the results by sales, but you can sort by certification date. So the most recent certification KISS did was back in 2015, and it was for 2 greatest hits albums, same day.
Wow.
The best of KISS 20th Century Masters and the very best of KISS were both certified gold on that day.
So you know what that makes me think, Michael, is like they love that stat of having the most gold albums. So that's the one thing they're going to zero in on with laser focus and make sure they keep adding up.
Can we get more gold awards?
Yeah.
Yep. 100%. Exactly. I mean, you know, you if Monster and Sonic Boom were even remotely close, they might go out there and try and get them certified as gold. But, exactly. You know, that's just the state of the industry. Now, these albums don't sell that much product, and neither of those albums are massive streaming albums or streaming singles. So,
yeah,
what's the point?
Yeah,
well, and I wonder how much correlation there is to album sales to ticket sales. Like, for instance, if you look at Garth Brooks, okay, like you were saying that his numbers, Martin, were off the charts. He always sells a huge amount of tickets wherever he plays. Yet you have other country artists that have also sold a lot of records, but the people don't come out to see him in waves like they do for, say, other bands. And I wonder if there's a certain population who buys some records who just like the music but would never go see them live.
Well, to your point, Tommy, in the case of Kiss, I know this was back on the Hot in the Shade tour. I knew somebody who worked at the record label at the time, and we know the Hot in the Shade tour did great numbers.
Yeah,
great numbers. Huge. For Kiss.
Mm-hmm.
For example, at the beginning of one of the first shows early on was at a shed in Chicago. It was pretty sold out, so it had to be 15,000, I would guess. And then obviously the record labels will track when the band comes to town, what's the pickup in sales post. Kiss only sold 800 units of Hot in the Shade following that show. And the guy at the record label told me, he's like, this has always been Kiss's problem. They don't sell units from the concerts. They will do, and you know, and we know that. I mean, that's kind of what Kiss's problem always was from the very beginning. Nobody was buying the records, people were buying the concert tickets. And that seemed to have still been the problem, at least back on the Hot in the Shade tour, that, you know, major market, like a number three market, Chicago, big show, sold out, radio support. And, you know, and keep in mind that even had Forever,
mm-hmm,
top 10 single.
Yep.
Sold 800 albums. Wow. In the next week's tracking of sales post that show.
Well, and
they would have expected a lot more for that sort of,
yeah,
ticket sales, album sales, or not album sales, radio airplay, charting, everything else. Kiss just never did it.
But I felt this way at the time. It seemed like when the Hot in the Shade tour started and started to get traction, everybody was surprised at how well it was doing compared to what happened with regards to the Crazy Nights tour. I wonder if the double platinum of Smashes, Thrashers, and Hits did more to put butts in the seats for the Hot in the Shade tour than the actual album.
That's a great point. You're probably right.
It probably did. And I think back then, and even to this day, what puts butts in the seat for Kiss? The show.
Yeah.
I'm just going for the extravaganza. I mean, Hot in the Shade
was
still only certified gold, and it was only certified back in 1989 when it was released. It's probably not even close to platinum in a lot of cases. So, yeah, I think, you know, we may not like it as Kiss fans, but the reality is the average population out there sees Kiss as a show.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going for the show. I'm not interested. Yeah, I've heard all these songs, many of these songs on the radio, but I'm not interested in buying an album, especially back then, but now, mm-hmm, it would be streaming it.
And for good or bad, there's something about Bruce Springsteen or Garth Brooks or certain artists and bands that just seem to capture the ear of more people. And I think nothing says that more clearly in Kiss's case than I Was Made for Loving You. I mean, look at how many bands have covered that song. And it's everywhere. It's been in soundtracks. Everyone knows that song. And I think that in order to have that Bruce Springsteen type of thing, I mean, look at Taylor Swift. Jesus, you can't get tickets to her shows here. And that's no joke. There's literally no tickets available. And now I see all these famous people going out of their way to show you a picture of themselves at the Taylor Swift show. So it's kind of an anomaly. And the thing is you can't look at one band and judge it by another or an artist. It's just certain people or certain artists just capture a wider swath of fans. But it doesn't mean that the music you're listening to, whether it's Dio or Motorhead or Kiss or whomever, is any less valuable. It's just, I think that so many more people, especially now, they look at things from a more lighthearted fashion. So the poppier stuff is always going to get more support and airplay. And that's why so many people have switched to country music, because it's less country than it used to be. And there's a palatable middle now where you have just enough fiddle in it to make it country, but the guitars are just soft enough not to be called hard rock. And that seems to be where people want to live.
I'll just jump in here about the, you know, the Motorhead situation. I remember looking into the numbers a couple years ago, and I'm pretty sure I worked it out that Ace of Spades would now be a gold record. And it's the value of that hit single, that one song that everybody knows. And so it did all the heavy lifting, but again, it's the same sort of thing. It's like, wouldn't that be a cool, you know, Maria's always sending out the new Motorhead news, this get remastered, this coming out again. You know, they seem to always, you know, have things to talk about with Motorhead. Well, what would be any cooler than saying Motorhead's got their first gold album in America? I think that'd be a beautiful story.
Yeah.
That is a cool accomplishment for them. But I, you know, as I brought up with Kiss, in 2023, if it was just announced that Motorhead finally went gold, you'd be like, really? Really? Yeah. That sucks if they've only sold 500,000 copies in this amount of time frame. So, you know, from a PR standpoint, there could be some of these people are looking at it from that way of like, unless we can either get a 10 million award, it's that or nothing. We don't want the measly little gold award. We don't even want a measly platinum award. Platinum award for an album that's been out for 20 years.
Yeah.
You know, and why we saw a lot of albums, not just Kiss, but being certified immediately, because that showed, especially back then, pre-internet, pre-streaming, pre-YouTube, that showed demand. That showed, oh my God, you know, because I remember it was like Britney Spears, like her first or second album was platinum the first day it went on sale, and they made a big deal out of that.
Yeah,
that's fucking cool. Now that's telling you a million people bought this in the first day, or a million people bought it in the first month. That's something to beat your chest about. To come back and go, I'm a band that's been around for 50 years and 500,000 people finally bought this album after 45 years, you're like, really? That's not, that on its own isn't worth bragging. If that one more gold album allows you to become the all-time gold champs, that's worth it.
Yeah. Well, and I think some of it kind of festers with the fans from high school and junior high and all of the shit that we took being fans of different bands, not just Kiss. That it's like, that's why I think it's even more important to the fans is that
we want it for our own break.
So I think you're right, what you said earlier, it's more important to the fans than it is the band.
It's always been. I mean, Martin, I'm sure you've seen this. Pick any fan base, it's the fans that are always up in arms about, why wasn't this recertified? That's not the right number. 100 million, that's not accurate. It's like they're the only ones that are really day in and day out questioning this and upset by this.
Yeah. Yeah, it's a fun one. It's a fun one.
It'll never go away. It's never gonna end. you know, and I don't know, maybe post KISS being done with the touring and everything else, maybe there will be something between them and the label where they're like, let's finalize this. Let's get everything where it is as of today. I don't know. You know, it could be interesting, but I guess I would only see that being interesting if they could come back and go, yeah, KISS Alive is a diamond album.
Right.
If KISS Alive is only 4 million, it's kind of like, maybe good for you, but that's not bragging rights after how many decades.
Yeah.
Well, and maybe some of it too could be literally nothing more than, okay, we're going to sell our catalog. And so the better numbers that we can get, the better our value looks if we're selling. Because I had read an article this week that Queen is now working on trying to sell their catalog for $1 billion. And look, Queen has always been popular, but Bohemian Rhapsody, I think, blasted that band into the stratosphere, that film. Whereas I think the Elton John movie did absolutely nothing for him. So Queen has great songs, but a billion compared to even Bruce Springsteen, who sold it for 500 million.
Yeah. But to your question, Tommy, nobody who is buying a catalog is looking at the certification numbers. They're actually doing real due diligence.
Right.
And looking at the actual quarterly accounting reports. That's what they're buying it off of. They're not going to buy. Somebody's not going to go, oh, holy shit, KISS just got recertified and has got 3 more awards. Now I want to buy their catalog. It's like, they've seen the actual statements saying how many albums have been sold.
Yeah, but it's like baiting a hook to get someone interested. Like when Mark puts on a dress to get a date, it's the same kind of thing. You know, if we have enough certifications, maybe someone will look a little closer.
But you know, I get what you're saying, but I, you know, you're talking major, big business by people in the industry. None of them are going, whoa, wait a second. KISS was never on my radar because they weren't certified. Now that they're certified, no, these people, they know exactly who they want to go after, and they have the ability where we don't have the ability to see the real numbers. You know, it's just like when you sell a house, you have the ability to look at some real financial numbers to see if somebody can afford a house, what the condition of the house, you know, more than you would get off of Zillow.com.
Right. But it there has to be another component to it as well, because Queen makes sense to me in the respect that they have so many songs that are beloved by so many people for so many different reasons, and you can use them in advertising, whereas Motley Crue, not so much. And there's no way that Motley Crue sold anywhere near as many records as Queen has, and they got 500 million. So there has to be another component besides just the numbers for an entity to invest that sort of money in. I think where KISS wins is they have a brand. Queen may not have a brand, or Motley Crue. I mean, they do, but not like KISS. So KISS really, it's the characters and the merchandising capability of those characters that far outweighs the music.
On 100%. I mean, you know, I wouldn't be surprised if, first of all, I don't see KISS selling their music. They don't own their catalog.
Right. That's a whole other.
And I'm pretty sure they sold off their publishing at some point during the mid 80s. But they own the trademarks.
Right.
They own all the licensed products. They own all of that, which I wouldn't be surprised if at some point, I mean, we did an episode on this years ago. What if Disney bought KISS?
Yeah.
You know, KISS is in a position that they could sell their trademarks and not even have the music be part of it.
Right.
Because there's enough value. There's probably more value in their trademarks than there is in their music. To the point of a lot of the artists, to the point of a lot of artists who sell their catalogs, many people who are buying them aren't actually buying the catalog because they're buying it for the ability to sell more albums and streams. They're not interested in the selling of another CD, selling of another vinyl album, another Spotify stream. They're interested, as you were talking about, Tommy, in can we take this song that's been part of American culture and can we license it to
Chevy,
you know, Star Wars or Disney or somebody for $100 million. Boom, that's the payoff they're looking for. So right. To that extent, Motley Crue could be as successful as Queen when it comes to that sort of stuff. It's somebody's got to sit here and go, that song is absolutely perfect for this placement. This placement in a movie, a TV commercial, whatever it might be, because the lyrics today for a Motley Crue song might have a completely different meaning than those same lyrics had back in the mid 80s because the band has changed. You know, it's a different, they still like to think they're bad boys, but they're not bad boys. They're a corporation. And if you grew up listening to Home Sweet Home and somebody can sit here and go, wow, I could license Home Sweet Home to some massive real estate company who will pay $100 million to promote their business.
Plus Vince sings it in a different language on stage every night too. So
exactly.
It's a worldwide appeal.
Yeah. Some of those videos are fantastic.
It's a different world when it comes to people selling off their catalog and their music, but I will be excited to see if KISS plays this differently and sells their trademarks off.
Yeah.
They're one of the few bands
can do it
that can do that. I mean, you could say that about the Beatles. You could probably say that about Elvis Presley. There's not a lot of other bands that the trademarks are worth as much, if not more, than the music.
No. It's an entity.
Martin, this was, it's always great having these discussions.
All right. Yeah. That was fun. Yeah. We'll talk again. You know, I got a KISS book coming down the pipe.
Well, give us a quick plug for your KISS book,
please.
Well, yeah, it's not out for a while. I don't even know when it's out. Is it August? Is it October? I'm not even sure, but it's part of the series that publisher is doing, the at 50 or at. So I did a Bowie at 75. I did a AC/DC at 50 and I did two 50th anniversary one album books. I did Dark Side of the Moon and Quadrophenia is coming. That's not out yet. But these are all these swanky, nice, beautifully designed coffee table books from Motor Books. And so I've got KISS at 50 coming. And it's essentially writing, you know, short encapsulated things on basically picking 50 KISS career highlights. And it's really nice layout and that whole
thing. Well, and it's actually going to come out. So you got that going for you too.
Yeah.
Did Three Sides of the Coin make one of the top 50 highlights in KISS's career?
Not quite. Oh, not man, quite. That would be fun. What a sad.
Gotta give the fans something to freaking get pissed at me about. No, Martin, make sure you before it comes out, especially once it's available for pre-ordering and stuff like that. We'll have you back on and we'll focus solely on that.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Great. No, this was fun.
Awesome.
Thank you very much.
Awesome, Martin. Thanks, Martin. Thank you so much, man.
See you. Thank you for your time. Yes,
you too. All right. Talk to you later.
Take care.
Yeah.
Bye. See ya. Tommy, that's always a fun discussion because I know talking about gold and platinum awards is always going to get KISS fans
upset.
Upset, fired up, upset. Mad at somebody. It's a complicated world, these award certifications. Mm-hmm. And
just like sports. It's like sports. People like to be, they'd like to emotionally invest in something that's bigger than themselves. And you see it with football all the time and the passion that fans have for their team. No different with KISS fans or Zeppelin fans or whomever.
Yep. You know, as a fan, I think it would be great to see more certifications.
Mm-hmm.
You know, stepping out of the fan shoes, I kind of think at this point, Kiss is probably like, why? It's not going to change anything. Yeah. We're not selling more tickets. We're not getting more shows booked. We're not going to sell more t-shirts. We're not going to sell more music because of it.
Mm-mm. In the same way, I don't believe them becoming part of the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame does anything either. I don't think that sells more tickets. You know, people are going to follow them because they love them. And that's the bottom line. And the new people want to come and see them for the show.
Yep.
Like, I've always heard they've got the greatest show. Let's go. You know, that's really what it's all about.
Yep. 100%. Homework for this week. I think it's pretty clear. What's your take on all of this gold and platinum certification and recertification? And do you have any ideas or thoughts on why KISS and their record label might not want to do it? Do you think it's going to change anything if it did get recertified?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Tell us we're wrong. You guys are great at that.
I do think they need to recertify Crazy Nights to prove that it's a diamond 10 million selling album. I know it is. I know Crazy Nights is the best selling KISS album ever.
I think you need therapy.
A lot of our listeners think that about me.
That's true.
All right, you guys know what to do, where to go leave your homework answers. We love we may not reply to all of them, but we love reading them all. We do read them all. Leave your answers on YouTube or on our socials or, you know, nobody leaves comments anymore on iTunes. iTunes is like
kind of
history. Yeah.
Well, and also too, I want to point out something that if you guys have a specific comment that you want directed at one of us, put our name in the comment because that it pops up and it's easier to see.
Right.
And I will respond, you know, as will the others. Well, Mark won't, but that doesn't matter. He doesn't respond to any of us. We don't even know if he's going to show up every week. It's a crapshoot, but the rest of us will.
Yep. Yep. All right. That's it. Three sides of the coin. We're done for another week. We'll see everybody next week.
Later.
You have something to say? Leave a voicemail or send us a text message. Call 320-515 Voices for Three Sides of the Coin. Provided by LarryDavisVoice.com and by JessicaMarsVoice.com. That's Mars with a Z.